Today I'm going to walk you through how temperature sensors work and how to choose the right one for your remote sites. All right, welcome back to another DPS blog. This again has been one of our more popular blogs, so I'm going to walk us through some of the basics here so you can get a feel for how temperature sensors are working and the different dynamics you need to think about as you talk about choosing one. So if we start here by looking at some basics about what is a temperature monitoring system, obviously if you're here, you probably have some sense of this is monitoring the temperatures at some kind of remote location where you probably aren't all the time, so you can't just feel it, obviously. This is about having a lot of different sensors in a lot of different places, or at least one place where you aren't most of the time. When we talk about why do you need this, well, it's very common at remote sites to have a couple of problems associated with temperature. Probably the most basic is going to be thermal shutdown. So even if we don't have permanent equipment damage, if we have to have our service go offline because we didn't monitor the temperature properly, that's clearly a problem. At an extreme, if you have a fire and you have equipment damage, this is a case where a little temperature monitoring system probably would have paid for itself 500 times over if you had had that in place ahead of time. These devices, any kind of monitoring system like this, acts as a form of insurance in a way. It's going to let you detect problems so that you can stop them before they become a major incident like this that is going to cost a lot more money than any kind of prevention ever would. There's also windshield time, which is the term for when your technicians or you yourself spend a lot of time driving out to a remote site when you may not have needed to. Maybe if you had had a good temperature detection system, you could have responded to it when you were in the area, closer to when it was still building up. But the only way you find about things is when they're at an emergency stage. That's not a good monitoring system, because now you have to just drop everything and drive out there. And so there's even a low-level amount of cost that you'd call a wasted maintenance expense. And that is a huge cost over time. So just knowing about things right at the moment helps you both handle them in a graceful way without wasting resources, and also prevents major incidents that are going to either kill your service or knock sites offline or both. But the good news is that sensors that monitor temperature, these are very common. There are many different manufacturers that make these things. It's a very common challenge that you're facing. So there are many options that are inexpensive and will get the job done. And as I mentioned, compared to the cost of not monitoring, it's pretty much a no-brainer. You should monitor temperature in some way. So then, of course, the question is going to be, what sort of sensor do you need to use? Well, there are really two major categories, but I will split the second one into a further two chunks, so I suppose it's really three. A digital or discrete sensor is going to be the most basic, and if you know what a thermostat is in your home, you essentially know what a discrete or digital temperature sensor is. This is something where you may well be able to, like a thermostat, set a temperature. You can pick a precise temperature that you want, but a digital or discrete sensor can only output a yes or no, or a one or a zero. And that, in this case of temperature, it's going to be, it's either too hot right now or it's not. And if you think about when your air conditioner is about to click on, nothing happens for long periods of time, it's cool enough in the room, but then slowly it starts warming up because it's hot outside and it's leaking into the inside of the house. And eventually you hear that click. And that is the signal to the HVAC, or the air conditioner, to kick on and start cooling the room. And then at a certain point you'll hear that click unlatch, or the click will happen again, and that will tell the system, okay, it's cold enough now, you can stop for a bit. That is what a discrete temperature sensor is. So if you want that kind of detection, that's massively better than nothing. But as you can see, if you set it at 80 degrees, you don't know if it's 81 or 181 or 281 degrees, and so that is less detail than you'll get from other types of sensors. So when we talk about the next more advanced type, those are analog sensors. These are going to be sensors that can tell you a specific value. It's like the screen on the front of a thermostat instead of the click. It was when it tells you it is this many degrees, probably down to the tenth of a degree. And that is incredibly more detailed than the discretes are, and it allows you to do other things. For one, you can set multiple thresholds. So in the example shown here from a DPS Net Guardian, you can see that there is a green zone in the middle, which would be our acceptable range. And then you have some bands along the outside. And on the high end, they go yellow and red. On the low end, they will go a sort of blue-green and into blue to be very, very too low. And this is makes sense for temperature. We have some clients where that we just go yellow and red on both the high and the low, because sometimes it's more about danger than it's just temperature. But for temperature sensing, you can see these colored bands make a lot of sense. They're cold to hot. And so when you look at these bands, you have to understand that this is what the monitoring device is seeing, and that is a lot more than just it's either a bad condition or a good condition. And so what you can imagine is that the system can make a distinction between a yellow alert, a minor, we call them minor over and minor under, and a red alert, which would be a major over or a major under. And that way you can respond differently to, hey, it's a little hot, we ought to get out there and check something out, but we don't need to drop everything, versus the unfortunate but important message that things have gone terribly wrong and we're way out of spec and we need to get out there very quickly. So that is where an analog temperature sensor comes into its own, and that you can check the temperature at any time, but especially that you can get those threshold alerts that are not just yes or no. There's more detail than that. And in a DPS product, we tend to put four thresholds, two highs and two lows at two different degrees of severity. So now, how do we power this? Or apologies, let's go back to the analog sensor. The one challenge with analog sensors is going to be getting them power. And that is the next topic, but let's actually we'll go through these two, and then we'll add on to the end. So, what does it mean to have to power a temperature sensor? Well, the good thing about discrete sensors, in some cases, if they are truly mechanical in the way that old traditional thermostats were before they became electronic, you may not need any power at all. This is just a piece of metal that, when the temperature causes it to deflect enough, it clicks together and provides electrical connectivity, and that can be picked up by a remote telemetry unit like the DPS Net Guardian line. That means that those are actually quite convenient, and that can be one reason why maybe you'd say, you know, I'll just use a discrete sensor. I don't have to power it. And that might be, there's some truth to that. But there are other ways to handle this. Of course, with analog sensing, it probably needs power, but that's not incredibly difficult. This section of the article describes two different things you can do. You can run a wire, obviously, to the device itself. You can also have a remote. Some of our Net Guardians have a built-in 12 or 24 volt power supply to give power to a sensor. Even if you're a telecom and you have minus 48 volt sites, we will do a little bit of voltage conversion for you, because it is one of the frustrating facts about sensors is sometimes they want a different voltage than you natively have out at the site. The other piece here that I want to mention, that I almost went back to talk about, here it is now, is using what we call D-wire, or a direct single wire. This would be bus-powered sensors, and these are something you will see in the industry. The DPS variation looks like this. So we have ports on our RTU on the top left of this diagram, and then you would be connecting via daisy chain from one sensor to the next. And this is convenient. This is a Cat5e cable where you put RJ12 ends on it and you just abandon one of the pairs. It's very convenient to cut nice custom lengths, but the critical piece here is that not only is it daisy chained, but it's bus powered. So you don't need to worry about powering the sensors, and that can be a huge aid when you're talking about installing these things in some kind of an efficient way. You don't have to worry about huge amounts of install labor and DC to DC voltage conversion. So once we have these sensors, which I think we've covered pretty well now, what do you need to look for as far as having an alarm remote or an RTU that's going to pull these things in? If you've done any research on the DPS website, we call those Net Guardians. Obviously, every manufacturer will have a different name, but the generic name for this is an alarm remote or a remote telemetry unit, or sometimes remote terminal unit. RTU will be that acronym. So if you have a sensor, it's not usually going to just be IP enabled on its own. Probably going to need to go to some kind of a gateway device, which is what this RTU would be. So as you're looking for that, what are some of the critical factors? I have many different videos on the YouTube channel regarding that, so definitely check some of those out on how to select a remote. But just to cover that briefly here, it is important, whatever protocols are in play, whether you need to send SNMP to an SNMP manager, or you need to collect Modbus from a generator, or whatever, or talk to maybe some sensors. There are some Modbus enabled sensors, for example. Whatever you need to do, make sure that RTU can cover those protocols. Also, look for a web interface, and it's because that's the simplest way to interact with the device, especially in modern times when IT departments may make it difficult to install software. And even if that's not the case for your organization, it still takes time, and you have to, well, where's that install file? Let's get the thing installed. Going to an IP address and opening up a web interface is very easy. And in fact, let me punch up a web interface for you here. This is what the login would look like in a NetGuardian, and I will log in. The system in this case is spending about 5 seconds to load all of the interface into my web browser so that now I can click around and look at different things. And I actually have a temp sensor here on the sensors tab, and here you go. You can see an analog gauge. So that is how that would look. Discrete alarms are on an alarms page, and there are many different things here that we can look at to monitor our site, but this is what you'll get inside of an RTU that is a one RU rack mounted device. If you want to see those, you just hop onto our product page, click on RTUs, and you'll see quite a few, mostly rack mount, but there's some that are designed to go into cabinets. So also, at an RTU level, we want nuisance alarm filtering. This is an ability to say, I don't want to get certain alarms because they're just going to, they're annoyances, they do not need to be responded to, it's too much. And so examples of this in temperature might be, I have my threshold set too aggressively. The thing sends alerts when it doesn't need to yet. It's not that bad yet. And so in the RTU context, that would be, if I go to my provisioning, this is where I configure everything rather than just use it. So this is my initial setup. If I go to sensors and I have that temp sensor, I could change my thresholds. I could say, you know, 85 is not so bad. Let's make it 89 degrees. Or I could manipulate it that way. I can also say, on the discrete side, let's say that I have a discrete temperature sensor. So we'll call this high temperature. All right, then when this thing goes off, maybe it's a sensor that generally works pretty well, but it does flicker on and off for some weird reason. It has little hiccups where it momentarily latches and then unlatches within a few seconds. That's frustrating. So what I could do is say, give me 10 seconds here. And that's a qualification timer. This is a function we build into our RTUs. So you could say, only tell me if the temperature is declared too high for at least 10 seconds straight. And then I can set it just on set. That way I don't have to worry about when it clears, maybe I let it clear instantly, but I require it to be 10 seconds to set. And that's just a way that I'm going to eliminate those false alarms, because every false alarm starts to train me and my team that I really don't need to look at the alarms. This is not an important monitoring system, and you do not want to do that. So having any kind of nuisance alarm filtering in some form, whatever your monitoring system is, can be very important. There's also historical storage of temperature values. So you look for devices that can log to a CSV. Obviously, it goes to internal memory, and then at some point you can download a CSV. We have some remotes that will give you a URL that a cron script can access. So if you're a savvy IT team and you think in terms of cron scripts and logging things to an SQL database, we can support that as well. So just look for whatever you need as far as the historical storage. It probably isn't going to be on the RTU forever. You probably are going to ship it out to some kind of central manager, an SQL server, some kind of long-term storage, because RTUs typically have enough capacity to store a couple thousand readings, but they won't store everything that's ever happened in the last few years. That's just beyond the scope of most RTUs. You want to make sure that your RTU can hold as many sensors as you need. So if you want to monitor temperature in 6 different places in a building, be sure the RTU can support that many sensors. Interestingly enough, as we're talking about monitoring temperature, we build at DPS 2 different temperature ranges for our remotes. You'll find our standard range is roughly a little below freezing to about 132 Fahrenheit. The wider range can be all the way up to 70 Celsius on the top end, and you can go down to about minus 40, which is the same in both Fahrenheit and Celsius. And that speaks to more broadly industrial grade durability. Not only should your RTU be able to survive your temperature extremes so that it can keep doing its monitoring job, but in general look for, and these are less obvious in brochures because it's a finer detail, but any manufacturer who has gear that's been installed for many decades has probably improved their designs. At DPS, we have engineering and manufacturing on site, which helps. One thing that you may actually look for that you'll notice on the bottom of NetGuardians, you might ask yourself, why do they use 25 or 30 screws to hold the circuit board into place? Well, you really need about 5 probably, just mechanically. And that has to do with with EMI reduction or electromagnetic interference reduction. And so if you have a part that's noisy or is susceptible to outside interference, if you have a ground attachment really close to it, which is the screws hold the circuit board into the metal and therefore ground it out to the rest of the, just ground out electrically, that is a tool we use to reduce our susceptibility to outside interference. So little details like that can go a long way in some of the unfortunately rough environments that our equipment has to survive in. Now, beyond that, now that we talked about an RTU, what about the top end, the master station? How are we going to look at the temperature readings? I showed you some screens in the RTU, but that's one location. It might be a few different temp sensors. How do I pull together 10 sites, 100 sites, if I have a large network? Well, that's where master station is going to come into play. We call the TMON. If you see an SNMP manager, that is another example of a master station. No matter who you buy it from, that's the function of that kind of device. And this is just about collecting everything and putting it all on one screen. You might think in terms of a map-based display. This is an example from our TMON. We call it the GFX interface. And while there is a text-based view that looks something like an email inbox, you can also put things onto a graphical display like this and see, hey, we got this site, it's blinking red, let's click into that, what's going on? Oh, look, the temperature is up way too high, let's get out there and fix it. So that is what a master station can do. It puts every one of your RTUs on a map so you can see all of the alarm incidents in a summarized way, and then, okay, something's going on, it's blinking, let's drill down. Okay, it looks like it's the temperature on this server. What's that about? And then you have a lot more information than you did 10 seconds before that. If we look at HVAC systems, you also have to think about powering those things. I actually, once on our website, our web host was off-site. We now host it ourselves, but prior to that time, we got a message that there was somebody who crashed into a power transformer, I believe it was in Texas, and they shut down power to the data center, which was okay because we had plenty of backup power, but there was no backup for the HVAC system, and that presented a problem that all of a sudden they weren't able to keep the cooling system going, and the site overheated and had to shut down. So do think about that when you talk about your HVAC system. Keeping your temperature in check will be accomplished better if you have a backup power system for your HVAC system. That way, if you lose power, at least the HVAC can still stay on. So you want to size your UPS batteries appropriately for that. Think about generators in the same way. Here's some quick examples just to show you what we've been talking about here. Two different RTUs, the Temp Defender and the Net Guardian. We have our D-wire temperature sensor and then the high-level TMON master station. There are links on this page. And of course, DPS, we would raise our hand and say that this is a place where you can find a quality monitoring system. There are many different options though, and I will freely admit that our gear is built telco grade and we build it in our factory in California. It's great for quality. If you need an absolute low end, I got $200 to spend on a temperature sensor, we may not be the answer for that. But no matter what, always give us a call, tell us what you're trying to accomplish, and we will always help you sketch out your options, even if that can sometimes lead you away from DPS. You know, that's fine. We understand that we're not going to be the solution for everyone. So if you have any questions about any of this, if you'd like to talk it over with me or another engineer here, just give us a call. The phone number, as always, is 1-800-693-0351. You can also send email to sales@dpstele.com. Once again, I'm Andrew at DPS, and I'm wishing you excellent network reliability.